SSH, or Secure Shell, enables administrators, engineers, and other advanced users to do remote login and remote command execution securely over unsecure networks. In this video, we're going to look at how we can authenticate SSH using FIDO2 with security keys such as this security key CNFC from Yubico. Before we get into the specifics though, let's take a step back and let's consider our implementation options. First of all, passwords and public key credential, if stored on file, on disk, should not be used. This leaves us with a few options: OTP, one-time passwords, certificate-based authentication, there are different ways of doing that, as well as U2F and FIDO2. Generally, anything public key cryptography based, okay, certificate-based authentication, U2F and FIDO2, is going to be stronger than anything shared secret-based like OTP, password, passphrase, so on. Coincidentally, all of these options, OTP, certificate-based authentication, U2F, FIDO2, can be delivered with a security key such as the YubiKey. Now, out of these better options, why pick FIDO2? Well, one reason might be that you're already protecting resources with FIDO2, right? Windows logon, web apps, maybe even RDP. Perhaps you're delivering that with FIDO2. It makes sense then to also look at, can we deliver SSH with FIDO2, right? Another reason can be cost. If you're able to deliver all of your use cases with FIDO2, then a FIDO-only security key is going to be more affordable than a multi-protocol security key. Conversely though, if you're doing certificate-based authentication with PIV, American Federal Standard for Certificate-Based Authentication, right? You might be doing Windows logon, server logon, RDP, UAC, web apps, native apps, etc. From that perspective, it makes sense to also look at SSH from the perspective, can we solve this with certificate-based authentication? Okay. Anyways, assuming it's FIDO2 that you want to use, what are the considerations, right? How is it done? That's what we're going to talk about, okay? The first thing is, we need to have OpenSSH, and OpenSSH is simply the most commonly used SSH implementation. We need to have OpenSSH version 8.3 or higher. We can find out by issuing command SSH space dash V, capital V for version, right? Unfortunately, it's not that simple. At the time of creating this video, both Linux, what have you, macOS and Windows, they all bundle this baseline version 8.3 or higher, but only Linux has enabled security key support. So on macOS, on Windows, we need to do a little bit extra, not much, but still. On macOS, we can use homebrew, the command being brew install open SSH, and then you're good to go. Similarly, on Windows, we can use the winget command. Winget install open SSH, one word, space beta, and we're good to go. Next, let's talk about key generation. And this is a command, I'm showing it on Linux Ubuntu, but I have tested it on Linux, Windows, and macOS. So, the important thing is we add the option dash capital O resident. Resident is a term we see in the specifications for FIDO. It's used interchangeably nowadays with another term, which is discoverable credentials. This term has since been sort of renamed by the marketing people to passkey, right? So with this option, we're effectively creating a hardware-bound passkey, and that is as secure as they come. Cool, isn't it? Now, the other thing we want to do is add another option. Again, dash, capital O, and verify required. By adding this option, we're making the security key and the FIDO credential, we're making it multi-factor. In the standard, you have something called user verification. And this is either a PIN, something I know, or it is a biometrical trait, something I am. And it's added on top of the factor you already have, right? The security key itself, something you have. On top of this, we have user presence, which is an interesting feature of FIDO. User presence requires the user to touch the security key. Why is this? It's not an added factor, no. But it is a control which will help mitigate remote attacks and malware-based attacks, because a remote attacker cannot touch your security key, can he, right? So we do that, we hit enter. What happens next is we have to provide PIN, so our second factor, or biometric touch if we have a YubiKey bio, for instance. And next we have to touch the YubiKey or security key. If you have a biometric device, the touch and so the user presence and the user verification could happen in the same touch motion. Anyways, next OpenSSH will prompt us for a passphrase. We're going to skip the passphrase. Why? Well, it's just typical OpenSSH, right? What we're doing here is we're creating a public credential, and as the name implies, it's public, it's not sensitive. We're also creating a key handle, or more correctly, we're creating a credential ID. That's what it's called in the specification. The credential ID here is just a pointer or a reference to our actual credential, the private key on the security key. Right, so it's not sensitive per se. At this point we're done, we could put both files in the user's SSH folder, for now at least. And let's turn our attention to the server side aspect of configuration. If you're using something like GitHub, it's very straightforward. We open up the public key part, we copy the content, and we paste it into GitHub, and we're good to go. Now we have SSH with FIDO2 and security keys. Real simple. If you're standing up your own SSH server, SSHD, it's also simple, but it takes additional configuration. So shown here again is Ubuntu. This is SSHD config, which is the main configuration item for SSH server. We want to make sure that we have public key authentication enabled. So that's typically enabled by default. We can explicitly add it if we want to. That supports FIDO, which is of course public key based, as well as U2F and certificate-based authentication as well. So we make sure that's in there. The other thing again is verify required. And if you think about this, why would we do this again? Well, we care about the security as resource owners, as IT or IAM leads or whatever. Maybe the users don't care as much. Maybe they create credentials without verify required. So by adding it on the server side, we have this additional layer, this additional control. If they fail to comply, we will deny them access. Right? So we save the file, we restart SSHD, we test it out a little bit. If things work, consider turn off password for root, consider turn off password authentication for all users. And then the final part of the little exercise is, just like with GitHub, we need to get the user's public credential onto the server. There are different ways of doing this. One is we use the SSH copy ID command. You'll quickly find this is a bit of a catch-22, right? Because if you turn off passwords, there's no way to get your public key onto the server, right? So you have to re-enable that for a bit. The other approach is we edit the authorized key file directly. And the authorized key file is where all the public key credentials typically end up. If you take this approach, you have to be very mindful of permissions on the file, on the directory, the ownership, and things like that. Also, each public key credential needs to be one line. So if the user has two credentials, we're talking about two lines, right? You save that, you restart, and you test it. Everything work, turn off passwords, right? And at this point, we have SSH with FIDO2 hardware-bound passkeys on GitHub, as well as to your own SSH server. So I hope this video was informative. I hope you learned something, got a few ideas from it. Thank you very much for watching.